reading from Jeremiah. My joy is gone, grief is upon me, my heart is sick. Hark the cry of my poor people from far and wide in the land. Is the Lord not in Zion? Is her king not in her? The harvest is past, the summer is ended, and we are not saved. For the hurt of my poor people I am hurt. I mourn and dismay has taken hold of me. Is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? Why, then, has the health of my poor people not been restored? Oh, that my head were a spring of water and my eyes a fountain of tears, so that I might weep day and night for the slain of my poor people. Tonight, many of you, I feel, and you have felt what the prophet Jeremiah does feel. My joy is gone, grief is upon me, my heart is sick. He asks, is the Lord God in Zion? Has God abandoned us? And you're asking the same question Jeremiah asked. Why? When Susan and I were medical missionaries in Kenya, many Wednesdays we would go to chapel and we would hear people say, God is good all the time. And others would answer, all the time God is good. And that is true. And it's easy to say when things are going well. But sometimes in life, things are not going well, and it's hard to say. Sometimes it's impossible to say. So what do we say then? We took care of parents who were grieving. Everybody. The child had been diagnosed with a malignant brain tumor. The child was in a coma because he had been hit by a metastasis of second degree. Or they were grieving because their child was paralyzed in both legs because he had been born in this kind of victim. Those parents never, ever said, God is good all the time. What they said was one way. Why did this happen to my child? It was the answer to that question that they really needed. Several years ago, maybe 2025, Rabbi Harold Pfister wrote a widely read book that was entitled, When Bad Things Happen to Good People. And Christo, a couple of years later, was at a conference on the youth of suffering. And he heard the Baptist minister John Quenfield, who had written a superb book after his daughter died. It was called Tracts of Fellow Soul. And Christo said to Quenfield, he says, John, the title of my book is When Bad Things Happen to Good People. And he said that if the title had been Why Bad Things Happen to Good People, it would have contained 3 words. I don't know. The most common reaction to suffering are the why questions. Why did God allow this to happen? Why did God cause this to happen? And we hold God accountable many times, thinking that God caused and allowed this to happen to make us stronger, to teach us something, or maybe to punish us for our sins. In the Bible, when Job experienced those devastating losses, that was the response that his three friends gave to him. They came to him, they said, well, at least a week, and then they said, Job, listen, you need to understand. God has taken away all of your land and your wealth. God has taken away your family. God has taken away your home because you sinned. The author Friedrich Beaton said, God never explained the bad question to Job, partly because Job was finite and could not understand it, just as a small enough child could never understand the gender of physics. But Beaton said, deeper reason is that an explanation, an answer to the bad question, is not what Job really needs. no matter the explanation, he would not know how to deal with the broken souls of the justice of the Lord. Job did not believe that his sin caused his suffering. He preferred the mysterious silence of God to the will of his friends, and neither should we believe that. But we still hear it. When William's own prophet dreamed of the chapel at Yale, his son Alex died in the college. Alex and his friends had been drinking, and on the way home, he missed a turn and went through a barrier and went into a frozen and icy lake and drowned. And in his memorial service, a few days later, a woman trying to be helpful said something like, "Well, what happened to the will of God?" And Coffin wrote later, he said, "I wanted to grab the lady and say, 'Lady, that's wrong. God did not cause this. It wasn't God's will that my son died. None of us knows enough to say that. God just carried on with my pleading and pleading to me.' When the waters closed in, the heart of God is the first of all our hearts to break. An answer to the why question is not what hurting people need. Does it really help you any if you learn that Dylan Root murdered those 9 people at Fairmont in Charleston because his father taught him since he was a child to hate African Americans? Does that help you? If you develop breast cancer, does it help only if your oncologist says that the reason this happened is because you inherited the BRCA1 gene, and that increased your chance of getting breast cancer by 80%? Answers to the why question are not what we need to do. Katie Billman is a professor at LSU, the Lutheran Seminary downtown, and she taught our class care for the bereaved and dying, while her own husband was dying of cancer. He died in his last year. I went down and talked to Katie recently, and I said, "What do grieving people really need?" And the first 2 things she said surprised me. She said, "We need to grieve. We need to grieve. To mourn, to live with the pain of our life. We need it." The second thing she said was about other people. She said, "We need them to be willing to be with us, even though we are grieving. Willing to be with us, to listen to us if we have words to say. Not try to say things that are helpful, like, 'Well, maybe you remember, all things work together for good for those that love the Lord.' But just to stick silent. Listen if we want to talk. And if we don't want to talk, just listen and pray silently for us, rather than wondering, what of the 5 things is it mean to see?" After the son of Yale philosopher Nicholas Wolfskill died, people asked him, "What should you say to people who are grieving and suffering?" And he said, "Your words don't have to be wrong. The heart that speaks is heard more than words that are said. The heart that speaks is heard more than words that are said." And he said, "If you can't think of anything to say, just say, 'I can't think of anything to say, but I want you to know that I am with you in your grief.'" Wolfskill said, "What I really need to hear is that you are with me." Grieving people often feel that God has abandoned them. The old theologians had a great term in Latin, "Deus absconditus," as if God had absconded and left them alone. And we feel pain. We feel pain as if God had abandoned us. even Jesus felt it on the cross. You heard the words, my God, why? Have you forsaken me? Why did you abandon me? We feel abandoned because the reality of grief is the feeling that God is absent. The reality of grief is the feeling that God is absent. And we need to be reminded of the truth that God did not, does not, and will not abandon us. The Christian word to suffering and greedy people is not that God caused what happened. It's not that God allowed it to happen. But it is that God is with us in our grief. In the first chapter of Matthew's Gospel, the angel says to Joseph, Mary's going to have a child. You'll name him Jesus, and he will be Emmanuel, God with us. In the last chapter of Matthew's Gospel, the last thing Jesus says to his disciples before he leaves them for the last time, remember, I am with you. I am with you. And we hear verses like that, and sometimes we say, so what? I've heard just as bad. It makes no difference. William Sloane Coffin said, the words of the Bible are true, but grief renders them angry. The words of the Bible are true, but grief renders them angry. Jesus said, I'm with you always, but he doesn't lie. And in our grief, we need to cling to the words of St. Paul in Romans 8, when he says, I'm convinced that neither life nor death, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of Christ. He meant that there is nothing, even grief, even the depths of grief, that can separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ.